Okay, thanks everyone for coming tonight. I would like to welcome you to the Register Mail Carl Sandburg College Candidate Forum. This is the first time we've worked with Carl Sandburg College on such a forum, and I'm pleased to see the turnout tonight. Tonight we have three Republican candidates running to be the nominee for District 74 State Representative. The winner, March 15th, will face Democrat Bill Butts in the November election. The current state representative, I think most people know, is Don Moffitt, who has decided not to run for re-election. We did, however, talk to Don before this and got some questions from him, so some of the questions that you'll hear tonight at least had his thumbprint on them. We hope you leave this forum tonight with a better understanding of the candidates and their stances on these key issues impacting local and state. So, I think first I'll introduce the panel. From the Register Mail, we've got Marty Hovey there in the center. Marty is a government reporter for the Register Mail, covers a lot of the state issues. He covers county government, he covers city government. Next to Marty, we have Ben Zichterman. We make Ben pretty much cover everything, but mostly he covers business and he covers education as well. He covers Carl Sandburg out here. And then the third member of our panel is Sierra Shepherd. She's a freshman at Carl Sandburg College, attending on a journalism scholarship. She's pursuing an associate degree and plans to transfer to a four-year university upon graduation. So I'd like to thank the panelists for coming out. In a nutshell, I'll tell you this. Each candidate here is going to get 2 minutes to answer the same question. So we'll alternate it so different candidates get the first shot at each different question. So we'll see how that's going to work. And I'd like to thank all the candidates for coming. And I think we'll just start things out with having them introduce themselves. And we'll start with, each one will have a 2 minute opening. We'll start with Dan Swanson. Dan Swanson, tell us about yourself.
Okay.
And why you're running for office.
Thank you. Thank you to everyone for coming out tonight. Quite a packed house. And it's nice to see that people are concerned and do want to learn and become familiar with their candidates. First, I want to start off with recognizing State Representative Don Moffitt, who isn't here this evening, and to his family for all he has done for our community, our district, and the state of Illinois. He's been a stellar person in the leadership role as our state representative. The decision to run for office for me was not my decision, it was my family's decision. We all spoke together and we talked about running for the office. I was in the military 27 and a half years, so, and I retired and was back home on the farm. And I was filling in on the farm, but just felt it was necessary to get the blessing from the family before I jumped into this. And similar to when I was in the military, gone to Iraq or gone to military training, the family was always there to fill in. Through our faith, we'll continue to grow to meet life's challenges and opportunities and adventures. I'm not looking at a second or third career. I'm retired from the military and enjoy each day as a gift. I served my country through my military service, my community as a member of Alvin's Board of Education and Henry County Board. I feel the time is right for me to serve my state. I don't believe politics is a profession. I believe politics is a public service. I will go to Springfield, serve my imposed term limits, and return back to my community and represent you. I support term limits. I support the independent map amendment. I support our right to bear arms. I support the rights of unborn children. I support our rights to free speech. I support public education, the rights of parents to teach their children at home. I respect and admire those who served in the military, police force, fire departments, and medical professionals and first responders. I will continue to carry on Representative Moffitt's legacy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Wayne Sleen, will you tell us a little bit about yourself and why you're running?
Well, I'm a third-generation farmer.
mic working?
Is my mic working? There we go. Okay. I'm a third-generation farmer. I live in Ryle. I was on the county board here for 11 years, so I have some experience in balancing budgets, and I thought this would be an ideal public service to continue. I was a volunteer fireman for almost 30 years. I served about half that time as a fire chief. I know what it takes to get involved in community service, and I want to continue doing that through being a state representative. I think that this is not a lifetime job. This is a commitment to the community, and I will self-impose term limits. I will only do 3 terms. I think that's critical at this stage of the game. We have too many people like Mike Madigan who go down there and lose sight of what they're supposed to be doing and work for themselves instead of for the people. I know we had great leadership from Don Moffitt, and he's not the one that needs to have term limits imposed on him. He did a fantastic job for everyone. But for every Don, there's 3 or 4 Mike Madigans, and we need to change that. Independent MAP will help with that. I'm in favor of that. I believe we need to work towards solving our budget crisis, so we need to be able to work across the aisle and get a compromise. But we can't cave in because what they've been doing for the last 20 years has not been working, and we need to make them understand what we need to do to make things better here in the state of Illinois.
Thanks, Wayne. Mike DeSutter, would you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Good evening. I'm Mike DeSutter. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to talk tonight about why I am running. Voters want to hear why a candidate is the best choice, not why the other guy is the worst choice. I'm looking forward to showing you that I am the best qualified to represent the 74th District. First, I am a successful businessman who knows how to budget, plan, adjust, and work with partners to get the job done. Second, I am focused on the immediate need to get Illinois moving again. We need to focus on growing the tax base, not the tax rate. Third, I am not interested in becoming a career politician. I believe in term limits and a fair map so that voters pick their legislators instead of legislators picking their voters. Those 3 things are what's going to take to get the state headed in the right direction. My resume is on DeSutterForIllinois.com and on Facebook. But I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself further. I'm a practicing Christian. My wife, Melanie, and I are proud of our kids, Charlene and her husband, Luke, our son, John, and youngest, Malin. I farm with my father, brothers, and nephews as part of a family operation. Our family is blessed with opportunity, and we've worked very hard to turn that opportunity into success. Agribusiness is the foundation of the Illinois economy. Farmers, unlike ag businesses, can't pick up their farms and move. It's time to manage our state the same way we manage our own businesses. We need a higher standard. We need to stop putting insiders into office, putting leaders place for a lifetime, and return to the basics of good governance. We need reasonable regulations and taxation. We need to reward work, balance budgets, raise up people who need a hand, and care for those who can't care for themselves. I'm running to serve the community. I will work hard to fix the problems, and then I'll get out of the way for the next generation can lead while I return home to the farm. I believe I am the right person to serve the 74th District, and I'm asking for your vote on March 15th.
Okay, they're all loosened up now, I think. Before we move into the question and answer portion, I want to, I forgot to say anything about the straw poll. Scott Erickson, Knox County Clerk, has been kind enough to do a straw poll here tonight. He's also our official timer, so I want to thank him for that. But you should all have a ballot. If you don't have a ballot, go up and get one. And as you leave tonight, please put your ballot in the box. It's up there by the door. So we'll have a little bit of fun with that. We will announce the results shortly after. So, and when we get done with the question and answer, we invite everybody to come up and meet the candidates. That's a big part of what tonight's about. So we'll move over to the question portion of the night, and we'll start off with Marty Hobie, and he's going to ask a question of Mike DeSutter.
Yes, so we're going to start again with you, Mike. My question is, for 8 months, the budget impasse has been in headlines and on minds of voters. How will this budget impasse affect the future of Illinois, and if elected, what would you do to change the direction of it?
We need to get the budget passed immediately. The longer we go, the more people are hurting. In my opinion, the state legislature and the governor should be sitting down at least 5 or 6 days a week until this budget is passed. And I believe that all legislators should be involved in the process, not just the four tops and the governor. Like I said, every day that goes by at this point, the year's almost gone. We need to do a two-year budget and get this thing moved along. A lot of people ask me, you know, what are you going to do when you get to Springfield? Well, and I, a lot of times I'll tell them, well, they need to pass two budgets before I could even get there. But they, one of the things I want to do is I'm willing to go to Springfield and make the tough decisions that need to be made. And I'm willing to do that, go down there and make tough decisions. And I think the state legislature and the governor is not making the tough decisions that need to be made. I'll give the governor some credit. He's put out a couple olive branches there to try and get things moving. But Magan and Cullerton, the two Democratic leaders, have not taken him up on that so far. But you know, I think we as citizens need to put pressure on our legislators to you know, get moving and get things done.
Wayne, again, with the budget impasse lasting now over into eight months, what would you do to change the direction of the state following this budget impasse?
Well, obviously, it's going to have a huge impact because we're operating off of a budget from 2 years ago, and we're operating off of revenue with an expired tax increase. So, therefore, the deficit has expanded from what would have been $4.2 billion to $6.2 billion. So we're going to have a larger deficit to deal with as we move forward. We need to sit down with the opposite party and discuss viable alternatives, which we need to create jobs is the number one thing. If we create jobs, then we're able to create revenue. We get people off state programs. We take that money and dedicate it toward paying our bills. We must sit down with the other side. They have to be willing to listen to what Governor Rauner is saying, because obviously what they've been doing for the 20 years has not been working. We need to get a budget passed, and sooner than later, but it won't happen until the Democrats decide they want to come to the table and operate in fair conditions. They don't want to do that. They want everything to be their way, and we can't cave in because it's not going to get any better if we continue doing that. We need to stand strong, fight against the Democrats, and make them understand changes must be made. Therefore, we can get a balanced budget at some point in time, but it's going to take probably until after the election in November because the Democrats don't want to negotiate.
Thank you. And lastly, Mr. Swanson, again, with this budget impasse lasting into its eighth month, what would you do to change the direction of the state following the impact it's had on our state?
Well, first, I'd like to start off with saying just what a mess, huh? I mean, this has gotten out of control. I was in Mercer County and met with the Mercer County Senior Citizen Administrator in January, I guess it was. We went and had a soup dinner. And she was telling me how she would like to hire a new employee to help with all the different programs she has. And she called me just a week or so ago and said, you know, this budget has gotten so bad, not only can't I hire anyone, but I may have to close my doors. You know, that's sad at a senior citizen center locally here to have her say that. What I would do is I would encourage all of us here to go home and encourage Republican candidates in neighboring districts to get elected, to notify people how to, because what we have to do, we have to break the supermajority. Madigan has his regime of all the Democrats in Springfield and elsewhere, and until we break that supermajority and get Republicans down there, we're still going to be the shortest pole in the tent. Use an Army expression, because we've got to break the supermajority. You know, there's other things that could be done to help strengthen the budget. You know, we could look at doing an audit of the Medicaid payments. How many recipients of Medicaid are not eligible no longer or live outside the state? You know, Texas and other states have done an audit and found millions of dollars that was over than what they had paid for that service. So I think there's a lot of things we can do. I intend to go down as a freshman. It would be tough for me to say I'm going to go down and change things, but as a freshman and as a prior Army leader, I know how to get things done and can get in the footsteps and get in the doorways of some of the people we need to talk to. But we have to get more Republicans in Springfield to help break this supermajority. Thank you.
This next question is for Mr. Saleen. It's about jobs. The local unemployment rate in District 74 ranges from 6.6 to 7.1% above the state unemployment range, rate of 5.9%. What would you do to help bring jobs to District 74?
The number one thing we do need to do is evaluate all the regulations that we have in place here in the state of Illinois. We need to make sure we're competitive with neighboring states. As we are so close to Iowa, we are losing businesses to the Iowa because we're not competitive. They're competing for the same businesses that we are, and our regulations are causing us to be uncompetitive. We need to evaluate them and eliminate the ones that are causing the most problems. We need to get businesses coming here, and we need to provide good jobs, not just low-paying jobs. We do that, as I said, change the regulation, we need to change the tax code, and we need to have true and honest discussion on changing the workman's comp rules here in the state of Illinois. Those are the three things that are driving the businesses out of our state at the highest level. We need to change all of those. The Republicans need to sit with the Democrats and force that through their mind that these things need to happen. As the governor has said, and I agree with him 100%, these changes must be done if we're going to turn our state around. We need to have open and honest discussion. We need to have these things accomplished, and we need to make sure that everyone understands it has to be a two-way action. Republicans can't do it by themselves. Democrats must come along and join. And I know some Democrats are feeling the pressure because their districts are getting fed up with them just as well, because they've promised things and not delivered. So there is an opportunity to have a compromise and get these things solved, but we have to work together, and those are the things we need to do.
Mr. Swanson, same question. What would you do to bring jobs to District 74?
Well, I agree with what Wayne said. Is regulations are what's killing bringing businesses into the state. It's interesting to note in 2015, 12,500 manufacturing jobs were lost in neighboring states. Just think of that, 12,500. In 2013, Illinois lost 81,000 residents, and it wasn't the people we lost, we also lost $4.1 billion in taxable income. $4.1 billion. And why did those businesses leave? Why did those individuals leave? Because we tax them too much, and because their businesses moved to another country. Illinois businesses lost in the Quad Cities alone was 2.4%, or 4,500 jobs. And as Jeff Mays, the director of Illinois Department of Employment Services, this past New Year, we broke a record. For the first time since 2009, Illinois ended a year with fewer jobs than what we started. And we've got to ask why. And I go once again back to breaking the supermajority. As long as Madigan's regime is in there and thinks the only way we can cure our financial struggles is by raising taxes, not only against us as the individuals, but us and corporates and our small businesses, we're going to continue to see losses within our communities. How do we fix it? Well, it's going to take an economical and political reforms. You know, we've got to enact the term limits. You know, the regimes we need to keep moving on. And the workers' compensation reform. You know, those are the two areas that we need to fix, if you will, before we bring businesses back into community, because otherwise it's just status quo, and there's no reason for them to come here to Illinois. So, thank you.
And Mr. Sutter, same question. What would you do to help bring jobs to District 74?
The state of Illinois has the highest unemployment of any state in the Midwest. We lose 56 jobs a day here in Illinois to other states. We got to stop people moving out of the state of Illinois and start moving people back into the state of Illinois. That's the only way we're going to grow revenue in the state, is to bring business and bring people in here. And we got to stop exporting our kids out of the state. In our colleges, we have more kids that are leaving the state for college, and a lot of times once they leave, they don't come back. We got to stop that tide. We got to bring them back. We got to bring jobs back to Illinois. We got to be more competitive. We got to pass a balanced budget. We got to take care of pensions. We need some tort reform. These are all things or why businesses are leaving the state or not willing to come to the state of Illinois. We also got to become more business friendly, have less regulations. We must, if we grow jobs, we'll grow revenue, we can grow ourselves out of this, or help significantly in growing ourselves out of this budget mess. was talking to a kid in Knoxville, and I was beating on doors last week, and he told me he's going to college here at Carl Sandburg, and he says, when I get down to college, I'm leaving the state. And I said, why are you leaving the state? So he says, I don't feel like there's opportunities here, and I even feel like if I do get a job here with the pension crisis the state of Illinois is in, I don't feel like it'd be a long-term goal. And I asked him where he was going. He says, I'm going out to the Kansas City area, because I believe that that's an opportunity for me out there that's better than the state of Illinois. I was saddened to hear that, but we hear it time and time again. Like I said before, we got to make the tough decisions. We got to turn the state around because we're heading down the wrong path.
Mr. Swanson, Governor Rauner vetoed Senate Bill 2043 last week, a bill that would have provided MAP grant money to college students. Do you agree with this decision?
You know, the answer is yes. And the legislation, Senate Bill 2043, was to appropriate $721 million for the monetary award program. The House and the Senate gave him a bill that there was zero sources to fund the $721 million. It was just looking for a reason to get another veto out of the governor. You know, that $721 million would have gone a long ways if it was there to help our senior citizens and others. The state of Illinois in 2014, the University of Illinois was $12,293 per student. The national average is $6,552 per student on the national average. And the reason the U of I's costs are so expensive, a couple reasons. A $2.3 million higher average worker compensation cost. $2.3 million more. Their liability insurance in the last 20 years went up 1,000%. So who do you pass those costs on to? Those students. And who do the students get the grants from? The state of Illinois. So it's a vicious cycle that needs to be slowed down or stopped. You know, again, some of the reasons those tuitions were so high, as I mentioned before, was the cost that the college is paying. But you also have to look at the unfunded mandates that they're being faced with also, just like us and our businesses, just like our other schools. Those burdensome regulations that we all have to go up against. And then also the procurement rules for how they procure and build their buildings on their facilities. There's a lot of extra costs there. So just by reviewing and fixing these couple things could help reduce the cost of those funds, the MAP funds, and spread it across more students as opposed to being able to afford a few students. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. DeSutter, same question for you. Do you agree with Governor Rauner's decision to veto?
I believe that both sides down there ought to quit, trying to one-up some or do something that makes them look good in the press and pass a budget for the whole state. I agree that we need to look at the whole budget, not just one item at a time. Unless the governor has said, give me a budget and I'll cut where I think needs cut if the legislature's not willing to do that. On the MAPS program, many colleges have not been funded or have not had increase in funding in years. And at junior college in the our major colleges in the state. A lot of them, like Carl Sandburg, have not received $1 from the state of Illinois this year. They did grant the MAP programs to the kids for the fall. They have not this spring. They can't afford to keep doing that, putting money out of their own pockets and passing it along. Like I mentioned earlier, the state of Illinois, another reason why we have kids leaving the state is because it's cheaper to go out of state to college. We need to be promoting the state of Illinois and keeping our kids here and giving them a break. In my opinion, why are we letting our kids go? My son's out of Iowa State. Number one, because it had an engineering program that fit him well, but two, it's cheaper to go out to Iowa State than it is to stay in Illinois. Now, I'm being honest, I mean, that's a decision that families make every day. To save costs, they'll go out of state. And a lot of times when them kids leave, they don't come back. So we need to fix this problem. We need to fund education. It's the most important asset we got is our kids. In K-12 and at the college level, we need to fund it, and we need to keep these kids here and promote Illinois kids.
Thank you. Thank you. That's the first round, and we'll go back to Marty Hobie. He's going to ask a question about pensions.
Did you answer that one?
I didn't mean to startle you. Oh, I'm sorry. We've got one more. I'm sorry. I was feeling kind of lonely over here, so.
Can you define your answer a little bit more? I don't feel you properly answered the question.
Would you like to state the question again?
Yes. Governor Rauner vetoed Senate Bill 2043 last week, a bill that would have provided MAP grant money to college students. Do you agree with his decision?
I said that I did agree with that. I think they need to pass a whole budget. The governor said that if the legislature wants to pass a budget that's unbalanced and give him the right to slash where he sees necessary, he would be willing to do that. But this piecemeal approach is not the way to get it done. State legislature needs to do their constitutional job and pass a budget and send it on to the governor.
Thank you. Mr. Saline, the same question for you.
Yes, I support his decision to veto simply because it's another example of an unfunded mandate being shoved down the throat of the local taxpayers. That's what we need to change. We need to allow local rule on those. So therefore, I do support his veto. But I am a supporter of MAP grants because I feel that it gives low-income individuals an opportunity to better themselves and make a better life for themselves. But what I would like to see them do is work with the community colleges, because we have so many good community colleges in this state, where they go to the community college for the first 2 years to get their basics out of the way and then move on to a four-year school. That will lower the cost of the education and provide opportunity for more children. What we need to do is also have some of these students that they understand they're not a four-year student. They're a two-year student. So we need to work with vocational programs with these MAP grants, get these kids going to these community schools, learn a vocation, come out of a two-year college with a skill, and become a productive member of society and start giving back to the state so we can make it great once again.
Okay, now we're ready for that. Marty Hobie's going to ask about pensions now.
All right, the first question goes to Mr. DeSutter. Earlier this year, Senate President John Cullerton introduced a pension plan that would allow state workers to opt for lower raises if they would be put towards their retirement benefits. Governor Rauner has backed this plan. Do you? And why or why not?
Yes, I agree. The current pension program is, I've heard figures all the way from $110 billion to $200 billion, depends on how you do the math on it. But we need to transfer out beginning workers and give the option to people who are already employed, give them the option to transfer out into 401k type programs. And I believe that a promise that the state has made, we need to try and keep. Anybody that's been in the program, ready to retire or has retired, we need to try and keep those benefits and keep those promises. But going forward, we can't promise that to the beginning workers, and we need to give options to those younger workers to opt out into a different program. That would help the state, and I believe it would probably help the employees in the long run. So I'm in favor. One out of every $4 of the current budget goes into pensions. That's unsustainable, one, and if we don't do something about it, it's going to get a lot worse. But one out of every $4, that's taking money away from a lot of other things that the state could be using for infrastructure, K-12 and college grants and a whole host of other things. We've got to get the pensions turned around. It's probably the biggest black cloud hanging over this state at this time.
Thank you. And again, sorry, I lost my place. Mr. Saline, again, would you support President John Cullerton's pension plan along with the governor? I apologize. Is there anything we can do about that?
I can hear those other
four. Again,
there you go.
Yay, we got it fixed. Do you support Senate President John Cullerton's pension plan along with the governor?
Yes, we need to make a solid line in the sand from a day moving forward on that. All new employees coming into the state will be under a different pension program than what we currently have. The state Supreme Court has already ruled that we can't go back in time and defund these pension programs, so we must find a way to fund those. We need to set a solid time moving forward. Every new employee will be under a different pension program. Then we need to start creating jobs, as I said before, get revenue coming into the state, get people off of state aid, and start growing our budget, our revenue into the state and dedicating that money toward paying these pension programs. These people worked under a contract that they negotiated, fully expecting to get their pension, and we cannot go back and take that away from them. Like I said, it's already been ruled by the state Supreme Court that can't happen. So therefore, we need to come up with new options moving forward to make sure that the new employees have a decent pension program for them, but understand fully that we've got to find the money to pay for the commitments that we've made in the past. That's where we need to create the jobs, get people coming back into our state, fill up our revenue, and put that money toward our pension debt, because it's going to be there, and if we don't address it, it's going to get worse until we end up going bankrupt.
Thank you. And finally, Mr. Swanson, again, would you back Senate President Cullerton's plan along with Governor?
Yes, I would support that. And I would also say, as has been said also, we must fulfill our obligations and commitments to pay the pensions as promised. We owe that to our employees to pay them as they thought they would receive that payment. But we also need some new ideas. I'm sure there's other states who have programs in place that we could model after. In the Army, our motto was, why reinvent the wheel? You know, why do we have to spend a lot of money to have someone figure out how to fix this pension problem? You know, there's already models out there that we could tailor after. And we can't continue to take funds from those accounts that are paid into the retirement account and the pension accounts. You know, we can't rob Peter to pay Paul, because eventually Peter has to have that money to pay out also. So that's one that also, we've got to leave those funds alone. When they come in, those dollars, we need to leave those dollars in their proper accounts. You know, we currently guarantee a retirement when individuals enter the job field. What we don't guarantee is that they'll get that money back. But what we should offer, or could offer, are other options of some other types of retirement funds. Let the individuals who are working, let them decide how to best invest that money, because it is their future. So, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Saleen, question about schools. Several local superintendents are concerned about what a property tax freeze could do to their ability to raise revenue. Would you support a property tax freeze, and if so, why?
I would support that at this time, simply because the property taxes have gotten out of hand. That doesn't mean your property taxes aren't going to go up. If your assessed value continues to rise, your property taxes will go up. That being said, the best way to solve that problem is to eliminate the state being involved in local decisions. Unfunded mandates need to be eliminated. The state can pass those if they want to pass those laws, but they should leave it up to local governments to decide whether they want to enforce those, because if they don't have the revenue stream, then they shouldn't have to abide by those unfunded mandates. If we allow decisions to be made locally with education, our programs will become able to fund themselves in a better fashion by eliminating programs or mandates that they don't need or that are unsuccessful. We need to allow individual people to make decisions based upon what their area can sustain. Therefore, the state needs to get involved as well, because they need to come with a different funding program from the state level. Chicago may not like it, but some of the collar suburbs up there are getting plenty of money from their property taxes and don't need state funding. I think we need to have a means testing and redistribution of that state funding to pay for schools that are in more need of state aid. There are schools in the Chicago area that are paying about $4,500 per student, where downstate schools are paying approximately $400 to $500 per student. We need to get that changed, because those schools up there do not need that state aid, and we have schools around here that need that, and that's obvious by what's happening here in Galesburg. So unfunded mandates need to be eliminated, but property taxes need to be froze to force the state to work through to develop a new program to fund the schools.
Mr. Swanson, would you support a property tax freeze, and how would you help school districts in their ability to raise revenue?
Well, I would support the freeze, as I believe it's in Governor Rauner's turnaround agenda, for 2 years. Anything over 2 years becomes a hardship on schools, on libraries, on local police departments, and puts them in a position where they may have to take out bonds. Having served on the Board of Education for 17 years, the further behind the state gets on our payments, the further behind the school is on paying their bills. So I would support it for 2 years, but as mentioned, the state needs to live up to their obligation. The Constitution requires that the state provides 51% of the of income taxes to the school districts, and that's not happening currently. Those funds are being misdirected to other places. So as long as the funding stream is fixed to the schools and they're able to work those 2 years, because that's going to be a tough hardship on those districts. You know, as I mentioned, it goes back to funding the schools. It needs to be a bipartisan understanding that we fix this money stream going into our schools. So that's all I have. Thank you.
And Mr. DeSutter, would you support a property tax freeze and why?
Yes, I do support a property tax freeze. You know, in schools, I think we need to focus on three things: equality, efficiency, and excellence. If you look at the Chicago schools, we spend nearly twice as much up there as we do out here in the rural areas. And the Chicago schools, it goes into they've got their own board up there, not local control really. The mayor and the board that he basically appoints controls it. And I believe in local control. I think local districts need to make the decisions on whether or not to consolidate or to make cuts in programs. I think we need to, from the state level, we need to hand down less mandates. We need to focus on Southern Illinois. My wife's from Southern Illinois. We own some property down there, and our property taxes down there, because of the equalization in land values, over the years they've gotten so out of whack over the last 30 years or so that this year our property taxes on the land in Southern Illinois is going up 50% to equalize out what we're doing. And I think we have that disparity in the state of Illinois with you look at the suburb schools and some of them with their high incomes, their high EAVs, and then what they're able to generate versus some of our poor districts down south, south of 80, and I think we need to equalize that a little bit.
Okay, now we're going to have Marty Hobie ask a unique question to each one of the candidates, then we'll get back to having uniform questions. Go ahead, Marty.
Correct. Each of you have different backgrounds with some overlap, and so we wanted to talk about some of the things you guys spoke a little bit about in your opening remarks, and as far as it pertains to why you're running and what you would do if elected. So the first question is for Mr. Swanson. What can the legislature be doing differently for veterans?
What they could be doing differently for veterans. I only have 2 minutes for this.
Yeah.
Wow, I could go for a half hour to an hour. What they could be doing differently is actually live up to what they said they were going to do. As I see it, as my tip of the spear on this question is, there are 92 state agencies in the state of Illinois, and only one state agency is concerned about the veterans. That's appalling. We have veterans who use driver's license facilities. When was the last time you saw a veteran's information in a driver's license facility? It's about educating the veterans. When was the last time you saw some veterans information in a nursing home? Just imagine the number of veterans there. So my goal would be to lead a collaborative effort bringing all these agencies together to start helping to educate and let our veterans know their benefits. I had a Korean War veteran come in my office with two Purple Hearts, bayonet wounds to his belly, needed financial assistance. I'm the superintendent for Henry County Veterans Assistance Commission. I asked him what he needed financial assistance for. He said, well, I needed to pay my medical bills. I said, did you realize you're eligible for veteran benefits, that you could use a VA health care? No one ever told me that. So within 30 minutes, one signature, one fax, and one phone call, I had the gentleman enrolled in healthcare. It was that simple. But he didn't know he was eligible for those care. So where do we go next? So it's about educating the veterans. I had a resource summit 2 weeks ago on February 10th where I had 26 agencies come to Kewaunee to talk to veterans about their benefits. Over 130 veterans showed up, and they learned what their benefits were and what those benefits are. So it's about educating the veterans. When the World War II vet came home, we went to the farm. When the Korean came home, we went to the factories. When the Vietnam vet came home, we went back into civilian life. I retired three times and was told how to get back into civilian life. They're the ones we owe a debt of gratitude and thanks for to educate them. Sorry about that, Scott.
Thank you. The next question is for Mr. DeSutter. More along the lines of what the legislature can do differently, but for you, we were hoping you could speak to the agriculture business. So I'm sorry, what could the legislature do differently for agriculture business? Excuse me.
Well, we need to make it more competitive here. I just got back this afternoon from New Orleans. Our West Central Board went to New Orleans for long-range planning, and we spent a day down there long-range planning, but we also spent a day yesterday. We was at a major agrochemical company that makes chemicals, and we went to their plant to see how they make their product there and ship it around the world. And then the afternoon we went to the Mississippi River and watched products being loaded on and off of vessels coming up the Gulf. And just goes to show how important, you know, the guy showing us around that barge facility talked about how important the Mississippi is, a superhighway for all commodity products coming up and down the Mississippi and really throughout the whole country. We can go up the Ohio River, go up the Missouri River, and so on. So it's a thoroughfare. So we need to be aware of how important agriculture is, basically, this state. It's number one industry in the state. Agriculture and heavy business is number one. That's what drives our district. It's what drives this state. We need to be business friendly, try and get and maintain ag businesses here in the state of Illinois, and we need to lower the regulations to be competitive in the state, and we need to keep our infrastructure here. The state of Illinois has some of the greatest infrastructure of any state in the country. We have the best interstates. We have all six major railroads that come through here. We got the best airports in the world. We got the best farmland. If we get all these things working in the right direction, we can turn Illinois around in a hurry, but we need to do that, and agriculture is number one.
All right, thank you. And lastly, Mr. Saleen, with your time on the Knox County Board, what would you say the legislature can do differently for local governments?
Well, that's a difficult question as well, because number one, as I said, unfunded mandates. I was railing against those from back when I first got on the county board in 2000, and they've just gotten worse as we progressed along. We need to eliminate unfunded mandates and let local governments make local decisions. We need to also have the state be timely in their payments. At this point in time, I'm not sure how far behind they are with Knox County, but I know when I got off the board, they were several million dollars behind in payments to the state. That just forces the county to have to do things to find alternative ways to create revenue to pay their bills. Because unlike the state of Illinois, the counties are held to the Constitution, and they have to have a balanced budget, and they can't go over budget. The state of Illinois seems to ignore the Constitution and just continue to spend money without having a balanced budget and without caring what the law is. They have creative ways of doing that by simply saying, we're going to just inflate our revenue to make it look like we're going to make that much, when they know full well they're not going to get that much. So therefore, my advice to them would be, why don't we have a realistic revenue base and then base our budget going backwards so we know how much we have to spend? Instead, they're writing a budget on how much you're going to spend and then trying to create revenue. It needs to go the other way. Find out what your revenue is going to be and then find out how much you can spend.
Okay, we've got two rounds under our belt here, and this is probably the time to warn you that we're slogging all the way through this thing. We're not really taking a break or an intermission, so I just thought I'd at least warn you that. Sierra Shepherd is going to ask the next question.
All of you list either education or job creation as a top priority. Mr. DeSutter, do you see a need to reform the funding structure for education in Illinois? If you do, do you see institutions of higher education as being a part of this reform process, and how?
I'm kind of unique from the candidates here. We have three kids. Our oldest one went all the way through public school. Our second one was in public and private school back and forth, and our third one's going all the way through private school. So I've got a unique perspective on public and private school. I've served on school boards of both. I think I'm an advocate. I think that in some cases, the schools that aren't providing an adequate education, I'd be for having those dollars follow the kid instead of going to the school district that they're from. I think that would help help schools be more accountable. I like competition. I think it'd create more competition. I think we'd have, private school. Our daughter goes up to Rock Island Almond. That's not for everybody. Not every kid's gonna. It's a college preparatory school. That's in their name. Not every kid's gonna go to a four-year school. Some kids are gonna go to a two-year school, and some kids need to be trained when they come out of high school for jobs. We need to develop everybody, and I think that junior colleges, especially in high schools, we need to let kids know and help them develop into what jobs are needed in the community, whether that's nursing in this community, or whether it's welding for John Deere, or plumbers, or whatever it may be. We need to foster them kids at a younger age and try and get them heading in the right direction. And consequently, the junior colleges like this, if there is a demand for a certain type of job, for like the railroad in this area, we need to, one, have a program, and two, try and steer kids towards that program to keep them here.
Thank you. Mr. Saline, do you see a need to reform the funding structure for education in Illinois? If you do you see institutions of higher education as being a part of this reform process?
Yes, I've already touched on that, where we need to go with means testing and distribute wealth of the revenue from the state to different areas of the state, because we have certain schools, like I said, around the Chicago area that are already flush with plenty of cash because of their EAVs being at such a level that they do not need state aid. So we need to have a means testing to allow money to be flowing in the direction that's going to help the most children. I think we need to allow charter schools to become more prevalent in the state, because that way we can get these kids, if they're in a poor quality education system and they so choose to want to better themselves, they can move on to another facility and get a better education. This will not affect the teachers, because as children move about, there's going to be a need for more teachers to move as well, because you cannot have so many, you will not be able to overload your classrooms with so many children. So we're not necessarily going to get rid of teachers, but what we might do is get rid of some schools that are underperforming. We need to allow the opportunity for every child to have their best opportunity for an education outcome that's going to make them be productive in our society. So therefore, charter schools are a good example. But we also need to think about these kids that don't necessarily want to go to college. We need to start working, which I've already talked to some local businesses, to create a local business, high school interaction to get some of these kids going out on a thing called an apprenticeship, where they're actually working on vocational skills. So when they come out of high school, if they're not willing to even go to a community college and grow those skills, they can get into the workforce and continue to grow their skills and become productive that way. I know there's a growing need here just in Galesburg for kids coming out of school that have basic skills as plumbers or electricians or other such things. So why don't we get the private sector involved, and maybe they can offset some of those costs. So it needs to be a cumulative effort between the state changing its funding, the schools understanding how to lower their costs, providing the best quality education for the kids, and getting the private sector involved and offering opportunities.
Thank you. Mr. Swanson, same question
probably
for you.
Probably same question, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm catching on.
Do you see a need to reform the funding structure for education in Illinois? And do you see institutions of higher education as being a part of this reform process?
Well, I'm going to start out with the first sentence of our state has an unfair education funding system. Probably nobody in this room would disagree with that statement. You know, and if you look at that, we range anywhere from $7,000 per pupil to $25,000 per pupil. And the state formula for that school that has an EAV, as Wayne talked about earlier, is still getting a piece of the pie at that rate. You know, that rate and those dollars should be more equally dispersed across the school districts and across the state. We need to ensure that all the students have the adequate resources they need to do their job, and that job to a student is to learn. And I'm kind of confused what our students are going to look like in a couple years when they enter college after spending 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, or 12 years of the Common Core education. You know, currently there are 135 mandates towards our school systems that cost them $200 million. And each time that mandate comes into them, It requires retraining and retooling, if you will, of the teachers, of the textbooks, and the tools needed to teach those students. And that's the same with the Common Core. The 135 are state mandates. Common Core is that national mandate that's costing us money in our school districts. We also need to allow the schools, one of the things I would do is reduce the Illinois State Board of Education. Let that money come to the schools. Let the boards of education, who you people in this room elected in your district, to represent and use those tax dollars in your district. That's how we fix these problems. It's at the grassroots levels. Let me work, let me have the money, show me the money, and I'll sort it out and fund the schools. Thank you.
This is for you, Mr. Celine. How would you work with Democrats who control the House to accomplish your policy goals?
The number one thing that has to be done is people need to sit down in a room and have open and honest discussions. You can't do your work on the floor in front of the cameras. That's just three theatrics, and that's solving no problems. As I said before, I've talked to some of the Democrats down there, and they're concerned because they've promised people in their districts things for many years and not delivered anything. They know that changes need to be made, but they're not going to be willing to do anything until after the general election in November, because Michael Madigan still has the purse strings. But they are willing to sit down and speak, and we need to do that behind closed doors, make everybody understand what we need to do, move in a direction that's going to accomplish that, and get it done. A leader is able to identify a problem, find a solution, and then get it fixed. You have to get a consensus to get those things fixed. I'm able to do that. I was able to do that when I was on the Knox County Board, and I think I'll be able to do that in Springfield. Now, to say that I can do that for sure as a freshman, probably not, but I will say I'll work as hard as I can, because that's what we need to do. We need to have a consensus to solve our problems, because as everyone here knows, we have a lot of problems. But unless they're willing to sit down and work behind closed doors, not on the floor, where everyone's seeing the theatrics, nothing will ever get resolved.
Mr. Swanson, how would you work with Democrats?
You know, through my 27 and a half years in the military, I've worked with many different nationalities, religions, ideals, financial classes, tall, short, you name it, the gamut, and the Army. And there's one thing I never asked them, are you Republican or Democrat? Because the idea was to get the mission done. And the idea was that we'll come together and work. And as a leader, I was able to instill in them the pride of doing a job and doing it right and getting it done. So how do we work with the Democrats? We work with the Democrats by beating up and getting that supermajority broken. We've got to get more Republicans down there. We need to have the manpower to go forth and do what we need to do. And it's all those strength in numbers. You know, during my military career, General Petraeus sent me to Kurdistan to sit at the table and mediate talks between the Iraq Army and the Kurdish Army to get those two armies to come together. And I did that. We came up and we developed 12 resolutions for which that Kurdish Army would join the Iraqi Army. Now, neither one of those were Democrats, neither one of them were Republicans, but I was able to, through leadership, to bring those two armies together. Unfortunately, politics has gotten in the way now, but if you look and if you watch the news, the Kurds are still fighting the battles. So can I work with Democrats? I've worked with a lot of folks. I've got Democrat friends, and we get along fine. Right, John? Thank you.
Mr. DeSutter, how would you work with Democrats?
I married a Democrat. And I'm still married, but now she's a Republican. So it's all about talking to Democrats and getting them to come over to your side. Now, I've been involved in many ag organizations over my years, involvement in Farm Bureau and other organizations all over the state. And, you know, we know people all over the state. I know people in the agricultural sector anyway. We come into a room, we tackle the issue, we come up with the best solution, and we move on. And I really believe that we can go to Springfield and work with, we all know what the problem is. We all know it needs fixed. So in my opinion, it shouldn't be that hard to go across the aisle and find some common ground somewhere. You gotta start somewhere. not everybody gets whatever they want in every negotiation. Everybody's got to give a little bit, but we need to cross the aisle. And, you know, I've talked to a couple of state legislators, and part of the reason why they're retiring is they're frustrated that the Democrats stand in one corner, Republicans stand in the other, and nobody's talking to each other. But that's not going to fix anything, and we all know that. We got to go down there and work with each other, find common ground, move forward, and get this state turned around.
Thank you. For the next question, we'll start with Mr. Swanson. Assuming that a capital bill is introduced and passed at the legislature today, what specific projects would you want to see done in the 74th District as part of that capital bill?
Part of the capital bill. Who drove here today in a car? What were some of those experiences coming here today? You can certainly remember the bump you hit or the pothole, and I'm not, this is not against, if there's any IDOT employees in here, this is not a slam, please. You only can do what you have the money to do. But we've seen that on our roads, we see that on the bridges. Look at the bridges, you can see the steel re-rods in the sides of those. This is scary. I mean, we've got a lot of work to do. And they've been neglected for the past several years. So it's not going to be an overnight fix. I believe coming up here in the next 5 years, we've got 20 construction projects in the 74th District, amounting to $92.6 million over the next 5 years. That includes fixing Route 150, includes doing some work on Seminary Street here in Galesburg, in Knoxville area. A lot of bridges and a lot of work's going to be done. But we're going to have to put up with that. We all know what the summertime means here in Illinois, road construction time. So we're just going to have to be patient because Representative Moffitt worked hard to bring these projects to us, and it's something we're going to have to deal with. And this isn't going to be very popular here in Galesburg. One of the big projects I see that I would begin initiative on immediately is Princeton. If you're familiar with Princeton, we've got a major railroad go through there, and the fire department's on the south side of the railroad, and industry is on the north side of that railroad. That fire chief has to drive 2 miles out of his way. And when you're the one on that ground who's been in a car accident and needs that ambulance service, that's 2 more miles that you've got to sit there and wait. So that's one of the main focuses I'm going to look at, is trying to help Princeton get a bridge over railroad tracks to cut down that distance for their emergency response vehicles. Thank you.
Dan, I had a quick follow-up.
Sure.
Most capital bills come with a source of revenue. And is there anything in your mind you would want to see new revenue come from?
Well, that new revenue is out of the fuel tax. I'm not one to raise fuel tax dollars. We've got to leave that alone. But what we have to do is we can't be transferring money out of the fuel tax. It's going to our roads and going to our bridges. It needs to stay put so we can do the repair work that we need to do.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Saleen, again, if there was a capital bill to come across if you were elected, what specific projects would you want to see completed in the 74th District?
Well, obviously, we have roads and bridges that need to be repaired, as Dan said. But what we also need to do is work with local districts or local villages and cities and see what they need. Locally, I've already talked with the Discovery Depot. They have a project they would like to get $1.5 million to expand their business there. It's going to bring in considerable amount more tourist dollars to the city of Galesburg if that gets accomplished. I haven't talked with very many other cities, but I know that they have projects that they would like to have done too. Those would fit under the capital bill. Roads and bridges as well need to be addressed, but that money should come from the motor fuel tax, which is separate from the capital bill. The way we're going to fund the capital bill is by cutting wasteful spending in various state agencies and consolidating our units of government so that we have less redundancy. We could take that excess revenue, put it in our capital bill, and fund these projects so we can get our roads and bridges repaired. And we will still have the money in the motor fuel tax so we can do multiple projects instead of limited to the amount that we're doing currently.
Thank you. And lastly, Mr. DeSutter, again, what would you like to see included in a capital bill for the 74th District, and how would you pay for it?
One of the things we need to decide right off the bat is what are our wants and what are our needs. And we need to take care of what our needs are, not what our wants are. It seems like every legislator puts in projects that are wants and not needs. And the state at this point doesn't have room for those. A couple examples I've read about is Speaker Magan gave a school up in his district $35 million extra above the normal school grant as a carrot or as a prize. And Senator Cullerton gave $10 million to a theater project up in his district. And I don't know whether or not that was a want or a need, but I'm guessing it was probably a want instead of a need. You know, so I think if we took the meat out of the, if we took out all the special pork, as you call it, that would go a long ways to doing a lot of the savings that we need and get the, I'm for infrastructure. I think we need to keep the infrastructure in this state, our roads, our bridges, our waterways, our airports. We need to keep them functioning, and we need to build them up and maintain them so we can be productive in this state. As far as revenue, I agree with Wayne. There's nearly 7,000 government entities in this state. That's too many, too much overlap, too many of those. We need to, one, give the option of some of these entities consolidating or putting some of them out of business if they overlap.
Okay, we've got about one more round of questions. We're in the final leg here. And Sierra Shepherd, why don't you kick us off?
Thank you. Okay, in the last decade, community colleges have seen drastic reductions in the amount of state money they receive. Mr. DeSutter, what solutions would you propose these institutions create in order to replace state money?
Well, one of the biggest problems that we have in downstate Illinois is that we have less population. If you look at the city of Galesburg here, back in the 70s, I believe the graduating classes at Galesburg were between 700 and 800. Now they're around 300. And it's that way all across rural Illinois. People are having fewer kids. They're having them later. We got less population around. So, you know, I think a lot of schools need to look, are they still relevant? Can they still provide a good quality education to our kids? You know, Illinois has as many school districts as nearly anybody in the country. And again, it's one of those things that I look at, you know, and I like to keep it on the local level, but maybe the state needs to provide some more incentives to have schools look into getting together. In my opinion, when I was on the Elwood School Board 15, 20 years ago, we was going through superintendents, and I asked the question then, why can't one superintendent take care of two or three of these smaller districts instead of one superintendent in every district? Now, I know that's not popular to bring up to an administration, and they may have a different opinion, but my opinion is that you know, we need to cut some of these costs down. I'd like to see the cost put in the classroom, and if we can get away with it by cutting some administration down, that'd be beneficial on my part. Did I answer your question?
I think so. Mr. Saline, what solutions would you propose these institutions create in order to replace state money?
Okay, I'm assuming you were talking about community colleges, not high schools. That
yes,
was your question,
colleges.
Correct?
Yeah.
Okay, what we need to do, as Mike stated, we are having smaller and smaller classes. So what we may end up having to do is working with other community colleges in the area to co-op on classes so that one school can cut a program, they can work together, and that will save money. You may have a class here, like the ag program that used to be here. It got down to the point where there was only two or three kids attending that class, so it got cut. It's unproductive to have these programs open and running when you don't have enough students to fill your classroom. So you need to co-op with other community colleges and work together to help eliminate cost. The state needs to come through with the money that they've promised, but that hasn't been happening. So each community college is going to have to sit down and do internal auditing to find out where they can cut corners and save money. Because at the end of the day, that's what it's going to come down to. The state will not probably be able to afford what the current spending levels are for several years. So to get through this hard time, the individual community colleges are going to have to make tough choices, and they're going to have to make some layoffs or cut programs or co-op with other schools just simply because the state can't come through with the funding.
Thank you. Mr. Swanson?
Well, probably same question, right?
Yes.
Okay. Well, you know, the community colleges, let's look at the major colleges first. Who's the highest paid employee in most of your junior or at your colleges? It's a football coach or basketball coach, $1.5 million. Wow, that's a lot of money. So now let's bring it down to the community colleges. Let's look at how they were designed to teach our students. You know, a good example I would use is Black Hawk East. You know, Black Hawk East has two tracks in their school. They have an ag class for that student who only wants to take 2 years of college at the in ag for an associate's degree, and they also run a track for students to go on to college at the four-level degree. So it prepares them in both directions, if you want to go to college or if you want to stay and go back to the farm. Blackhawk East also has great technical or technology classes, teaching students how to weld, teaching students how to work on the wind turbines that are out in our district. You're going to have to be more focused and more specialized to meet the students' needs. Once again, it's let's look at how other people do it. Let's not reinvent the wheel. There's other opportunities out there. The funding for the schools, once again, it goes back to a positive business climate. If we get businesses in our community, businesses who need students, we'll start seeing enrollments increase. But when we have a 6% unemployment rate, there's a lot of folks out there that can do that job. So, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is kind of coming full circle back to Governor Rauner's turnaround agenda. Many of you have said you support his items on this turnaround agenda, but Democrats have said there needs to be some compromise on some of the items. So the first question is for Mr. DeSutter. Are there any particular items on the governor's turnaround agenda you could see compromising on?
Well, I look at the governor's agenda as a short, long-range plan for Illinois to get us turned around. We're not going to do them all at once. And I don't think he has any intention of getting them all passed at once. But we need to get started on it. And I think we need to focus on making the state of Illinois more business friendly, bring down some of them regulations that are burdening us. We need to fix the pension problem. We need to look at tort reform. We need to look at a lot of these issues that's dogging the state of Illinois and causing jobs to leave and not allowing people to come to the state of Illinois. And as we go down the road, there may be some of those ideas that he has that'll change form as we move forward. But I think overall, all his policies have merit to them. And we know what's not working in the state, and we can't keep doing the same thing and expect different results. You gotta make some changes. So I'm willing to give Governor Rauner a chance on some of his issues and see where we are down the road.
Just a quick follow-up, Mr. DeSutter. I should have clarified, the question is in terms to the current state budget impasse. So what would be some of those items you would put towards the long-term category?
I guess I'm not following you.
So I'm talking about compromise to solve the current state budget impasse. And you talked about some were short-term, some were long-term. What particular items of the governor's turnaround agenda would you put in the long-term category?
Well, right now, Democrats aren't agreeing to nothing. So anything that they'd be willing to compromise on, I think pensions is number one. It's one out of every $4 is being eaten up by pensions. Paying back bills. The state's paying over $50 million a year just on interest to back payments. $50 million to go a long ways to, providing funding to our education sources or to our infrastructure or to anything. We need to get the agenda turned around. We need to get the budget in line, and we need to take care of pensions. I think pensions and the budget are the two top items in my estimation.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Swanson. I'm sorry. Mr. Saleen, I apologize. Again, what parts of the turnaround agenda could you see putting off to get the budget impasse resolved?
The only thing that I would be willing to compromise on right now would be the collective bargaining. With the proviso that we address that as we go down the road. We need to get something done on the budget, and the Democrats are not willing to cave in on anything. I think that's one thing that we could throw out there where they would come on board and start making these necessary changes so we can start creating jobs. Collective bargaining is something that's going to have to be addressed, but if that's what it's going to take to get a budget and get the rest of the agenda moving forward so we can start fixing our problems, I would be willing to put that off for a few years, but we can't put it off forever. It's going to have to be addressed.
Thank you. And Mr. Swanson, again, what parts of the turnaround agenda would you be willing to compromise on to get a budget passed on the state budget impasse?
Well, first off, we go back to we need to break the supermajority so we don't have to have these discussions. But if you were going to do any, probably the provisions on bankruptcies for local communities, that we could negotiate and something could be put off. And it goes back to building our economy and building businesses and having business growth within our economies and within our communities. We don't need to worry about those bankruptcies. And we see that doesn't work. That's not working out so well for up in Detroit, but that's something we could let go by. Some of the apprenticeship programs you've talked about, possibly something that could be put off till further time. Don't know if it's that carrot that Wayne spoke of, but you know you got to throw them that carrot and see what happens. But it boils down to there's a lot of good plans in here. You know, I think the unemployment insurance reform needs to be looked at. Some of the other good points is the term limits. I think that's non-negotiable. That has to be put into place. And that's something I would not give away very freely. That's something I would work very hard to keep as a part of that turnaround agenda is the term limits. And then as mentioned earlier too, something that's important that we keep in there is a pension reform. Reestablishing and look at other models to see how we can do it. But there's some little things in there that could be thrown out as that carrot. Don't know if it would get a nibble on it, but personally I think we just charge on. So.
Dan, again, kind of a similar follow-up to Mr. DeSutter's. What would be some more long-term things, if you could clarify that, please?
Well, long-term, like I said, that municipal bankruptcy.
But what I mean is by putting it off to get the budget impasse, but looking at it long-term.
Fair share, maybe something we could put off for long-term, but... I just support what the governor's trying to do on the turnaround agenda. So,
my question is about workers' compensation. That's part of the turnaround agenda, and I guess, do you support that, and would that endanger workers in District 74? This first goes to Mr. Swanson.
Workers' compensation? Parts of that I agree with the minimum wage. Let me restate that. I don't believe that the minimum wage is something that we can negotiate. I believe that where do we set that at? We set it at $20. I believe we're going to what, $12 in several years. So I think the minimum wage is one. Can you restate your question again, please?
Yeah, I'm looking for where you stand on workers' compensation. Would that endanger workers?
I don't believe it endangers workers. I believe we could see some cost savings in the workers' compensation plan. So as I talked earlier about, that's one of the major costs that the University of Illinois is spending many millions of dollars on. So I guess that's my answer.
Mr. DeSutter, where do you stand on workers' compensation?
Yeah, I'm in favor of looking at workers' compensation and reworking that. I think the state of Illinois is a little out of line compared to other states. It's one of the reasons why companies don't like to come here, because workers' comp and tort reform, I think also we need to look at, because there's in my opinion, I'm not at all opposed to protecting workers, but we need the employer needs protected also, in my opinion. So I think we need to look at workman's comp and work with it a little bit and fix it.
And Mr. Saleen, same question.
From a business aspect, we have the worst workman's comp laws in the country. That's why we can't get businesses to come here. I am all in favor of workman's comp for the employees, but we need to find a way to have causation. They need to prove that they got hurt at work. There's too many cases coming before workman's comp claims where people weren't necessarily hurt at work, and the settlements are being made. It's next to impossible to fight a workman's comp claim, because the arbitrator will come in and say, we'll make a settlement with them. It's going to be cheaper for you to make the payment than to go to court and prove you were right. So therefore, we need to change the causation clause to make them prove that they got hurt at work instead of us proving that they didn't. But workman's comp is a necessary tool for the employees. If they get hurt at work, they should have some sort of financial settlement. But they've got to prove it was at work, and we need to change that whole structure, because our costs are so prohibitive, nobody wants to come here and do business.
believe we have time for one more question.
Yeah, we can get one more in, I think. You guys were a little brief on a couple of those, so we're happy we can squeeze in another question.
So shame on us then.
And thank you for being respectful of the time limit, too. We've had no problems.
So we'll start with Mr. DeSutter. A task force led by Republican Lieutenant Governor Evelyn Sanguinetti has identified areas of government to consider for consolidation, including townships. Do you support her proposal to consolidate townships into county municipal governments? And also, what other parts of government would you consider consolidation?
Yeah, I know that one of the biggest lobby groups in the state is municipal governments. And, you know, I think it comes down to township consolidation. If you got a good road commissioner, you don't want to, and if you got a bad one, you probably do. But in my opinion, overall, we need to give that option to townships to consolidate. You know, in my opinion, I don't believe that every township needs a road grader and every township needs a backhoe. And in many cases in our rural areas, it's hard to find someone to become a road commissioner and a good one. And I think we'd be better off in many cases, not all cases, but in many cases, to consolidate, give the townships the opportunity to consolidate and work together and downsize government.
Thank you. Mr. Saline, again, would you be in favor of consolidating township governments? And also, is there any other parts of governments you would consider for consolidation?
On the township side, I can see the need to consolidate. We have way too many units of government in our state. But the problem is, if you consolidate and you put it all into your county's going to grow on their expenses, and that's going to create a hardship for those counties. It's also, they're going to have to hire new employees, get more equipment, and they're going to have more union costs. Everything is going to escalate. Are the townships doing it cheaper? Maybe, maybe not. It would have to be evaluated on an individual basis. Co-oping with other townships is a good way to eliminate some forms of some townships, but still maintain that individual touch that you can get better service in your area. I know that I have a good road commissioner, and I don't want to lose him. But Mike's right. Some people have bad road commissioners, and they'd like to lose them. So therefore, that would allow neighboring townships to work together and co-op to maybe cut their costs and still provide the service. So I'm not necessarily in favor of getting rid of all townships, but there are townships that need to work together. I'm not in favor of shoving all these townships under the county because I know it's going to increase the county's costs. And without state funding coming to offset that, it's another unfunded mandate, and it won't be able to be paid for.
Thank you. And lastly, Mr. Swanson, again, are you in favor of consolidating townships, and are there other areas of government you would consider for consolidation?
You know, I talked about the 92 agencies currently at the state level. That's where I would start. I would not start at our townships. You know, our townships, sure, they may be local government, and this is one of those cases where one shoe does not fit all. You know, in the larger cities, you have cities and townships all under the same area. I think it's Gurney, for an example. You know, a road commissioner or township commissioner up there receives $85,000, possibly. I shouldn't say that, but they receive a lot of money, and they don't have the responsibilities our road commissioners have out here in the country, because the roads are taken care of by that city hall or by the city crews. So that one shoe does not fit the state of Illinois. You know, let's look at those places where they have duplicate efforts, duplicate streets. Last time I checked, Andover, the city of Andover I'm most familiar with, they don't have the capabilities to do the township roads. They handle their own city roads. And I can't believe at the county level, think of any county, Knox County, Henry County, Mercer County, when that equipment all consolidates in one location and you're sitting at the corner of the township farthest away, when do you think your roads will be get cleared? You know, so think of that when you start thinking about consolidating governments. There are other places to consolidate, as I mentioned. So I'm not in favor. I like to have local control, and there's nothing more local control than that road commissioner, township supervisor, and those folks within our own communities that, hey, when you go to that pancake dinner, you can say to them, hey, Bob, how come my road didn't get cleared off? But that won't happen if they're consolidated to a larger level. So,
thank you.
All right. I think, Sierra, let's get one final question in here, and then we'll still have time for some closing statements.
Well,
One more.
Thank you.
I know I already said one more time ago, but yeah.
All right. Mr. Saline, do you believe that there is a connection between education level and employability? If so, how would you incorporate institutions of higher education into your plans to create jobs?
I think there can be a correlation, but there doesn't necessarily have to be. That's where we go back to creating this vocational program in the high schools and in the community colleges where these students can come out and have a skill, a marketable skill. They can get into the workforce, they can grow throughout that company rapidly if they have a marketable skill. Instead, they're coming out of school and they have no skill whatsoever. Therefore, they're not being able to be employed, and the education is getting, the people with the higher education are getting employed ahead of them. We need to get the VOAG programs going. We need to get these schools working with the local businesses, get these skills developed, and allow these kids to come out of a two-year school with a marketable skill and start working toward being a productive member of society and helping grow the state. We'll be able to grow our wealth through revenue growth by having these people employed instead of on state aid, and we need to get those things going as soon as possible.
Thank you. Mr. Swanson, would you like for me to restate the question?
Please.
Do you believe there is a connection between education level and employability? If so, how would you incorporate institutions of higher education into your plans to create jobs?
Well, if a higher education means a technical school, then that's where I think we need to look too, at the technical schools. You know, there's those students who want to go to the higher education. There's those students who want the four-year college degrees. Unfortunately, today that doesn't always mean a job. You know, how many have seen know of a friend or someone who went to a four-year college and then does not have a job? So there's no guarantees with that. Most technical schools are aligned with businesses, and you could come out with the certainty of a job and employment. So, you know, as students come out of school, it's up to them to make those decisions. Do I want to go to higher education and pay 4 years of college, or possibly go to a two-year college and have a better chance of employment opportunities? So, you know, we have students come out of our schools. Been several years ago, we had a student come out of Alwood with a perfect SAT score. And he went on to a four-year college, and that was his choice, and he's very successful today. We have other students who, like me, struggled in school, and the Army was my answer, you know, for me that struggled. But, you know, we need to align our schools based upon what we have for employment opportunities within our communities. So, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. DeSutter, how would you incorporate institutions of higher education into your plans to create jobs?
I think I answered this before, but so we don't get another question, I'll reiterate it again. That I think we need to develop programs starting at younger ages in our high schools especially, and maybe even a junior high, to try and give these kids a focus on what they may want to become when they get to college. And one, I think it's our parents' duty to find out what our kids are interested in and maybe try and steer them in directions that they may like or thrive in. But I think our schools need to be involved also in trying to steer our kids in certain directions. You know, a lot of times the kids just don't know what's available to them out there. Whether or not, you know, in this area, we look at the railroad, maybe we need diesel mechanics, or we need healthcare workers in this area. Or we always need plumbers and electricians and contractors, construction workers. You know, and a lot of kids, they're busy being kids. They don't think about, you know, what am I going to do when I grow up? They're having fun with their friends now. But we need to help them focus on what they want to work with, and we need to work them towards that in the junior college or the four-year college programs. And I think that, you know, our colleges would be more than happy to work with the high school to try and channel those kids in the right direction, because the junior colleges want to know what they need to be offering also.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm not going to stick another question in there. We're unless you twist my arm, Mike. We do have 1 minute closing statements from each of the candidates, and we'll start with Dan Swanson.
Thank you, and thank you to everyone who came out this evening. You all could have stayed home and watched a Republican debate, but hey, you got us instead. I want to thank my wife, Tammy, who's here with me this evening, my son, Matt, who's here. Matt's a graduate of Illinois State University. My other son's a graduate of Western Illinois University. I want to thank Marty for his coverage on this election. I think you're doing a fine job of covering the election and keeping in touch with the candidates, and really appreciate that, Marty. You know, I'm one that believes our state representatives and our senators are doing a fine job in Springfield. They're toe-to-toe every day in battles, and I haven't seen them surrender yet. And they're fighting the good fight and working for us. I will do the same thing as your public servant. When you go to the polls, 15th of March, ask for a Republican ballot. Remember, this is a primary, so you do have to ask for a ballot. And I ask that you vote for Daniel Swanson. My grassroots campaign is working hard to earn every vote through a handshake and a commitment to you as your elected public servant. So thank you.
Mike DeSutter.
Thanks again for the opportunity to talk tonight to why I am running. Illinois needs more successful businessmen who know how to budget, plan, adjust, and work with others to get the job done. We need a leader who is focused on immediate needs to get Illinois moving again. And we need someone who isn't interested in becoming a career politician. Those things are what it's going to take to get the state headed in the right direction. I may not have all the answers, but I will make you one promise. I will work harder than anybody to get the job done. My resume is at DeSutterForIllinois.com or on Facebook. I have put God, family, career, and community service at the forefront. I am running to serve the community, and I will work hard to fix the problems. It is time to manage our state the same way we manage our own businesses. And I am the best candidate to take the message to Springfield from the 74th District. I'm asking for your vote on March 15th. Thank you.
Wayne Celine, can you bring us home?
I'm not sure. You sure you don't have one more question?
I've got more questions.
Okay.
Don't provoke me.
Okay. The Illinois State House is ablaze in unfunded mandates, massive debt, unfunded liabilities, and leading the country in exit migration from our state. These problems cannot be solved through words. They need to be solved through actions. We need to address these headlong because the state of Illinois and the 74th District are suffering. We need to fix these problems by cutting wasteful spending across various state agencies and consolidating government units to eliminate redundancy. We must have leadership in Springfield that's going to be able to address these, and I've been able to address those things here in Knox County. Leadership is something that you have to show every day, and you do that by finding your problem, finding a solution, and creating a consensus to get it done. We have to work together to solve these problems. I'm willing to take action in Springfield to help solve these problems because I'm tired of watching the suffering of the people of the 74th District. My name is Wayne Celine, and I'm asking for your vote on March 15th so we can make this state great once again.
Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the candidates for coming out and the panelists for asking the questions. I would like to thank President Lori Sundberg for having this forum here. I think we'll be doing this in the future as well. And thank all of you for coming out. Don't forget to put your ballot in the straw poll on your way out. And I know it's past a lot of your bedtimes, mine for sure. But come on up and meet the candidates. We've got 30 more minutes here. And we will announce the straw poll results at the end of that 30-minute period, we hope.